and welcome to our latest edition of Breaking Down Barriers. My name is Jenna Heilman, and I'm the Executive Director of HDYO, and I'm so beyond excited to have this fantastic group with me today to talk about a subject that is sometimes little known, especially in Western communities where we tend to have certain representation always at the table as far as who is really impacted by HD. And so it's really important for us as a community to have cultural awareness around different struggles within the overall global HD community. And I have three panelists to talk about their own experiences they see from community members, and in order to really help us understand how we can do better at further understanding, do better at having representation at the table from multiple communities impacted by HD, do better in hearing these stories. And I really want to stress that we're hearing from only a few communities today, but we want to continue this conversation further so we can better our understanding across the globe, because we know that HD does not have borders. So I want to start off by allowing our panelists to introduce themselves, and I'll call on them individually. And I'm going to start off with my friend Dom. Dom, would you like to introduce yourself?
Sure. So hi, everyone. My name is Dom Thomas. I am located here in New Orleans, Louisiana. I am at the Center of Excellence here at Ochsner Medical Center. And I also represent HDSA National Board of Trustees. So my connection to HD is all through medical and also through my community and my family that is here. HD is very close to my heart, as rare and genetic as the disease is, but then also being a person that represents a different culture that is underrepresented in our HD community, that I'm excited to talk more about with our panelists today.
Thank you so much, Don, for being here. Juan Carlos, would you like to introduce yourself?
Thank you. Hello, everyone. My name is Juan Carlos. I'm from Costa Rica. I'm the founder and the president of the Huntington Disease Foundation here in Costa Rica. Something about me, my relationship with the Huntington disease is from my mom. She is an HD patient since 10 years ago. And my grandma, she passed away years ago by HD as well. I'm at risk right now. I decided not being tested yet. I'm a nurse. My job is in the health ministry in Costa Rica as epidemiologist, and I have a postgraduate degree in palliative care as well.
And I'm going to also add in there that you also are one of our amazing ambassadors, and you got to attend Congress last year too, and is also really active at Factor H.
Yeah, I'm an HDYO ambassador. I'm so proud to be one.
I have to just add that in there because I'm so proud of our ambassadors and the many different people who are part of that. And last but certainly not least, Jacky.
Hello, everyone. My name is Jacky. I was born and raised in Hong Kong, but now I live in California, Southern California. So I'm really excited to be here. My personal connection to HD. Actually, I don't have any family members who are affected by HD, but I have been serving the rare disease community, disabled community, and HIV community before. And I have some of my clients in the past who are affected by HD. And I just joined this community, but I'm really excited. There's a lot of amazing people that I have met along my journey so far. And I cannot wait to meet more people and contribute, you know, to this community with my skills and knowledge. So I'm really excited to be here today to talk about cultural stigma. So thank you so much for having me.
Absolutely. And Jacky joined our team back in February as our social worker. So he's a really great resource to have and brings a lot of different experience to the table. So you may have been seeing some of his posts on social media talking about different mental health tools and tips throughout the last months. And we'll continue to do that. So excited to have Jacky a part of this conversation and our team. Well, as I mentioned a little bit, this purpose is to really talk about cultural stigmas within Huntington's disease community, but this can really be applied to many different factors out there. So especially for those researchers who are out there or the medical professionals or just general advocates, this is such an important conversation to have, and we need to continue to have it until we have equitable representation and have all the education out there in order to engage different community members. And so this conversation is really near and dear to HDYO's heart and our mission, but I'm really curious, and I want to open it up to you all on the panel. Why did you want to be a part of this conversation?
I guess I'll start. And you know, this is something that holds very near and dear to me. And I've had multiple conversations of wanting to see more diversity in not just in research, but just in general, being able to go to events, educational events, being informed of what's happening in the community. And being able to have some representation of more diverse as the population that, you know, that is pretty close to what I serve here down in New Orleans, as you can kind of imagine, I have a higher number of African-American patients that have Huntington's disease. But, you know, as I continue to travel the country and meet more and make connections with our folks, I don't see as much. So as I talk to my community here and I talk to communities around the country, it's what can I do to help bring about change and bring that stigma of, you know, some of the things that we'll talk about later. You know, how do I bring about those cultural differences? How do I make it more warming and inviting for someone of African-American descent to want to come to the doctor and build trust and have those different things? So for me, it plays a major role for me. It's also a major role in what my community, that they're excited to see someone that looks like them. And I'm always excited to bring forth the, you know, the joy and the love of being that connecting person for them. So this is just near and dear to me. And yeah, there's so much more I can say, but I'm going to have my other colleagues on here answer as well.
Yeah, definitely. Thank you so much, Dom, for sharing. So as a social worker, and I have had experience working with multiple communities, such as the Huntington's disease community, AAPI community, LGBTQIA community, disabled population, and people of color. And I think it is important for me, like as a social worker, to participate in this conversation, because this topic addresses, you know, the intersections of different like the identity, cultures, and also health disparity. And I also think that my social work experience have made me really, really acutely aware of the importance of understanding and we need to challenge cultural stigmas altogether as a community. Yeah. So also in the context of HD, I think like cultural beliefs and societal attitudes can significantly impact access to support and care. So I think it's really important to foster an open dialogue and try together dismantle those barriers and try to promote inclusivity in this community. So yeah, so that's why I'm here today to discuss this topic. Yeah.
I consider that this conversation is a really good opportunity to represent a valuable resource to be able to provide more information about Huntington's disease and say to the worldwide who we are and who are the people that is immersed in this process. I think that it's a way to contribute a global Huntington family to raising a social awareness, because we are not alone and we have to know that we are not alone around the world.
Absolutely. No, thank you all so much for sharing. And I think that it can be a difficult conversation to have, and it can seem awkward, but it's really that open communication and conversation that allows each of us to grow. And we were at a conference at Vanderbilt, Dom and I were, and there was, it was part of a kind of a training session with Vanderbilt for different HDSA Centers of Excellence and Social Workers. And there was a family that they were profiling in order to say, how would you handle it with regards to certain types of medication? And at the end of it, they did reveal that this family was African American, which those conversations do make a difference. And those pieces do make a difference, not because of anything that's hurtful or, you know, that makes it difficult to work with. It's more of the sheer fact that there are these behind the scenes cultural stigmas, fears that can be present within different communities. And so it does matter. And so if we don't have these conversations, then we don't have the ability to look deeper into this to say, how can we holistically support these families and community members? So that's just one example. But there are so many more. And it's really important to have these open-ended conversations and questions to really dive deeper into that. So I want to jump into some more questions. And so just based off of communities that you either work with or identify personally as, what do you see that are some of the challenges when it comes to sharing about the many impacts of HD to one's family? So really thinking about, it could be sharing interfamiliarly, so between family members, about how HD is impacting you. And then also outwardly to maybe some of those outward family or friends who you might have a really strong social connection with. What do you feel like are some of those barriers that you've either witnessed yourself personally or outside when working with other families impacted by HD?
Yeah, I can start first. So in Asian cultures, I think there's a lot of, there's an immense pressure to maintain like a family harmony and uphold traditional values, right? So there's a Chinese saying that every, you know, bad news or sad news like should be behind closed doors, should not be spread around. This mentality is very common in Asian cultures as well. So I think this kind of mentality or this kind of belief or traditional belief can pose challenges for individuals impacted by HD who may fear stigma or judgment, from their families, if they or other people or their peers or people like their friends, if they disclose the condition. And also disclosing the impacts of HD, on them, like to friends and neighbors or or their broader community, can sometimes be met with misunderstanding or isolation because there's a lack of awareness and also the cultural beliefs about illness. In some religions, right, in Asian cultures, they think it is a curse. They have all these negative connotations about when someone's having this disease, and they think it's something shameful. It is like a disgrace to the family. So that's why this kind of stigma is really prevalent, in our culture, that especially when I'm working with the Asian communities, and I have witnessed that a lot. Yeah.
I think that our society usually is very fatalistic and associate the disease process with the death or maybe just with bad news. We don't think that we have the opportunity to share who we love and to do something that makes us happy. I think that the society feels a fear for rejection, and for the social opinion is very important for us, and to lose relationships or maybe lose friends because we have in this process of HD, we have to change our kind of mind.
Yeah. Going, a little bit, Jacky, of some of the practices in your culture is some of the things that happens in the African American culture. So in our culture, it's, you don't talk about what's going on with mom, dad, grandma, sister, brother, uncle. Mom, dad is just sick. And no one tells you exactly what they're sick from. There's not a conversation in our culture of, even saying from high blood pressure, just to use that as another example, as something as simple as that, as saying, You don't know that grandma had high blood pressure, but you don't know that, you know, grandpa might have had Huntington's disease, but it was a hush hush that we kept grandpa locked away in a room, away from family. No one talked about it, or that, you know, uncle just was a little bit crazy and they knew that uncle maybe had HD, but that was not something that was talked about. So in order to help, you know, you have that cultural stigma of, we know who the crazies are in our families, but they're just crazy and everybody else is just normal. And it's a, you know, it's almost exactly, like I said, almost exactly the same stigmas. You don't talk about it in the African-American community. You don't talk about anything that's wrong with anyone inside of your family, no matter what disease process it is. And, you know, as we, you know, we're coming into the world of, you know, the 21st century of modern medicine and things, it's how do we help change these cultural differences? How do we change our, you know, the way that we were raised in our families, of being able to talk about these things to help our families live a lot longer? And so those are just, you know, very similar between all of our cultures, of the different barriers that we face, which just seeking out information to help us. It's very difficult, especially for even growing up in my own family as an African-American, of finding out, what was my family history background? What did grandma have or grandpa had? It was like pulling tooth and nails. And I see Jackie shaking, because it's probably the same thing in your culture as well. It's like, it's such an hush hush. But what can we do to help change that as we continue to move on into, you know, this 21st century with modern medicine and bringing in more diverse folks like ourselves that are educated and understand, how can we help change those cultural differences? So, yeah.
Juan Carlos, I want to pick on you a little bit to dive into your personal experiences, because you have been aware of your grandmother who had Huntington's disease. You directly support your mom as a caregiver right now. Did you come from a very open family talking about that from the get-go? And what have you seen from other families in Costa Rica and others that you've worked with how open has that communication been for them?
Yeah, from my family, I have a lot of experience, because my grandma passed away when I was 8 years old. So when I was a child, I remember that my grandma was sick, and my mom told us, to my brother and me, that she's in a process, she's losing opportunities, and their needs will increase with the time. In Costa Rica, my experience with other families is that it's not too easy to talking about Huntington disease, because the people feels a lot of fear to lose maybe the abilities or skills, and has a lot of fear to death process and the disease process, because when you need that your brother and or your mother help you to eat, you feel that you are losing something. The families are not prepared to talking free about Huntington disease.
Thank you for sharing that. I just really wanted to get your personal perspective with that. And I think what all of you are saying really rings true to what we see too globally, because I think there are some misconceptions that, and there's been a lot of work being done on raising awareness about Huntington's disease and the openness of it, but it does tend to be community specific. And so that's where that true representation matters, because if you see someone who looks like you, who speaks like you, speaks the same language, sharing their perspectives, you may be more likely to reach out, right? And that's the first step, or at least continue to listen along. And it's really those first steps and really figuring out what is that environment that you feel safest with to reach out. And so these conversations and this representation really matters to try to cross that bridge to get more people seeking out support and encouraging that open communication, even inside their family, which can really be challenging.
Yeah, of course.
Yeah.
What do you see are some challenges when it comes to the general awareness and education about HD?
Okay, I can start. I think that maybe the society ignorance, because nobody knows how you are feeling as a family member, as a patient, as a caregiver. Nobody knows how you are feeling, how you are living this process. The fear that you feel when you see that your mom is losing something about their skills or maybe abilities, the incomprehension with your family, when you are tired, when you have to go to your work and go back to the family, and you see that the process is continuing and is not slowed down, and promote empathy. I think that is very important that the society understand how we are feeling and what can they do to help us to live in this process the best way that we have.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, thank you so much, Juan Carlos, for sharing. I think in Asian communities, and specifically, I believe that their general awareness and also education of HD are often lacking. Yeah. So when I started my job as a social worker, HDYO, I told my parents, my sister, they were back in Hong Kong at that time. They don't know, oh, what's this about? You know, like they don't have any idea. And it wasn't, you know, in Hong Kong or in China, you know, in Asian countries, often this is not something they heard about, like they hear about all the time, or they don't even know what it is, right? And also there's a lot of myths or like misconceptions, you know, or lack of knowledge among, you know, even healthcare providers in Asian countries. They have limited awareness and understanding of HD because due to the relatively low prevalence, right? Maybe in some areas. And also, because of their lack of awareness, lack of knowledge, sometimes they may misdiagnose someone, or they don't have the resources and they don't know where to refer them to, or they just, most of the times, you know, individuals, you know, in Asian communities, they're suffering from HD. They have nowhere to go. Yeah, they don't have organization, right, to promote, to stand up for them, for their rights, for their resources, for their, you know, any support, right? So it is really disheartening to see in some communities they have that lack of, you know, access, you know, to resources. Yeah, and I think more awareness, more education can be done, you know, in some of these areas, yeah, especially in Asian communities, yeah.
Yeah, and then, you know, it's, Jacky, I think it's almost a little bit similar in both of our cultures, some of the cultural stigmas, but then also, you know, dealing with, especially with the misdiagnosed part of the lack of education from providers, that a lot of our African-American community gets diagnosed with schizophrenia. And then it's also, you know, either schizophrenia or some other mental disorder. And that's also from the lack of being able to get a clear family history from your family. When it's really in reality, by the time we actually see them, it's actually Huntington's disease that was in their family. But of course, you know, there's a lot of lack of education sometimes just from, you know, a lot of our general neurologists that we do see that are not specialized movement disorder specialists, that, you know, and who are not partnering maybe with a genetic counselor or someone, that we're not seeing a lot of that education that we should see, or being able to have our you know, especially in our African-American community, when you say a genetic counselor, they're like, I don't want to go see a genetic counselor. So it's like, let me bring you more awareness on what a genetic counselor does. What does this do? How can we help to educate? And, you know, when we're educating more about, you know, more about HD, it's in our African-American community. It's just, it's so many stigmas of just trying to figure out, you know, how to lessen that. And how do we, you know, how do we sit and make sure that, you know, when they're going to their primary care doctor and there are so many different things, how do we continue to educate them? How do we keep our social workers educated out in the community and in the hospital staffs? How do we continue to, you know, create that general awareness of, you know, getting nursing homes to understand that sometimes Huntington's patients come in a lot younger than your normal patient that are going into a nursing home. So just creating that general awareness and education, but then bringing it back into our cultural that these things happen in our culture. But how can we make sure that it doesn't happen much more too long? And how do we help bring forth that? And I think that with us being kind of like some of, you know, trusted faces that people probably trust within our community, we can help change some of that dynamic.
It kind of sounds like from that, Dom, that it's barriers of education within the community, but then also with the medical community, because we see this a lot where someone does have the bravery to reach out and try to advocate for themselves. And sometimes there can be a little bit of a brick wall, maybe unintentionally, but there are so many different steps to getting diagnosed. And this happens in Huntington's disease in general, especially with juvenile HD, where it's, you know, how can we look at all these different components of it? But when you hit that wall coming in, it can be really easy to turn away and just not go back. And so it's really important for that dual education and kind of openness, it sounds like, with what you're saying.
Absolutely. And especially, you know, I know we haven't touched much on juvenile, but especially with our juvenile HD families that are dealing with, you know, dealing with the stigma of, okay, is this autism? Is this ADHD? Is this, you know, my child is just at a, you know, a teenage and just having outbursts, and thinking about, yes, you know, you do have a positive, you know, parent, mother or father who may be positive, but what about if it's all these other things and so much educational barriers that we have to go through just to make sure that, you know, we're taking everything out. But then you have some people that just go straight to, okay, yeah, we know that their parent had, let me just test them without testing everything else. So it's like, we have to create that general awareness and that general education to help out, you know, to help out our families and our communities. And I think that's just across all of our cultural things on that part.
Oh, that general awareness is so important. Absolutely. I think some of the points that we've brought up too comes with access, and mm-hmm. access can look very different depending on where you live. In the US, which I think it can be really, again, people think that we have these amazing services and we do, but it can be really specific to where you live and traveling long distances, having money. And then there's also cultural stigma and access and different things that have for length oppressed and made things more difficult. So I wanted to share just your experiences when it comes to access. So access to healthcare, access to support and resources. What are some of the barriers that you've seen in your communities?
Yeah, definitely. I think there's a few things I want to point out in regards to access. So first of all, in a lot of Asian countries, you know, there's like their healthcare infrastructures being like a little bit like limited, and also there's a shortage of specialized medical professionals, clinics, facilities that are equipped to diagnose and also manage the Huntington's disease symptoms and this diagnosis. So there's a lack of healthcare infrastructure in many Asian countries, I would say, and also it tied into like the geographic barriers. So in a lot of countries like where I'm from, like China, like it is really large and geographically diverse. People, especially living in rural or remote areas, they may have like significant challenges accessing their healthcare services, like because of the long distance, or they have difficulties with transportation, and they in their rural village, they don't have any medical facilities, right? So it is hard for them to get the support that they need. And of course, finally, the financial constraints. Yeah, because it's really expensive. Yeah, a lot of in Asian countries, they maybe Huntington disease genetic testing, the diagnostic test, the medications, you know, all these or doctor's appointments, those are not usually covered under the insurance, or people don't even have insurance, you know, in Asian countries. Yeah, they don't have the well-established insurance system like US. You know, people usually, for example, in China, they go to community clinic and they pay like the low cost, you know, medication and low cost, you know, doctor's consultations, but for general illness. But when it comes to like, you know, rare disease or like specialized testing, those you need to pay out of pocket, you know, go to big cities, right, to find like a specialist to see. And those costs, not a lot of people can afford. So I can see that there's a lot of limitations, you know, here with access to support and care. Yeah.
Yeah. My experience, or our experience in Costa Rica, is that social insurance provides the basic support in the health public system here in Costa Rica. However, there is not a wide range of services or disciplines that contribute to the quality of life to these people. It's really difficult for some families to pay maybe a physical therapist, occupational therapist. It's difficult because they have a lot of needs that they have to cover with the money that they have. Likewise, I know that in Latin America, that some public systems of health systems have some problems in offering patient assessment, like in Costa Rica, because we have a really good health system in the public system, but we have a lot of opportunities to increase the assessment to the HD community.
Thanks. And then I just, you know, me thinking about access in our community here is spread pretty thin. So we call ourselves, where I sit at here in New Orleans, we call ourselves the Gulf South Gap. So for HD care, there is us here in New Orleans, there's Houston at UT Houston, then your next stop is UAB. So we see patients from the Florida Panhandle all the way through Texas, basically. And in the whole state of Louisiana, Mississippi, which can be 6 to 8 hours drive. So you can imagine, you know, we're seeing patients and access to be able to get in. The barriers of not being able to get in, but the barriers of being able to get to your appointment. Now offering, you know, we do offer virtual visits. We make some exceptions to, you know, how we can, you know, help patients manage to get in to see the providers, to see us. We try to have this one-stop shop where, like what Carlos is saying, like access to physical therapists, occupational therapists, well, we do like this one-stop appointment. But there's still that cultural difference of my patients that are in certain communities that are even close nearby, who may say, Dom, I don't want to come see all of those therapists. I just want to come and just talk to you. And I'm like, if I can get you to just come talk to me, I can help you get access to these other entities that we're offering. It's also how I, you know, we help build, you know, when we're looking at geographically, and we're looking at, you know, the state of Louisiana, as most people know, you know, we're ranked 49th out of 50th in healthcare. So we don't have, you know, great healthcare. A lot of our Huntington's patients are either put on what we call our state Medicaid program. And, you know, that's what they're depending on to help with a lot of their benefits. We're looking at the multiple different things that they continue to progress and how can we support them. And a lot of our families are, you know, not financially stable. They don't have, you know, access funds to pay for, you know, different things that they may need, whether that's a shower chair or, you know, a walker or things that may not be covered by, you know, Medicaid or through or being able to pay for those extra necessities because they've maxed out on their benefits. From a medication standpoint of, you know, them possibly needing grants, and they just don't have that support that is needed. And then a lot of them are, you know, afraid of, you know, like, hey, if I come in, am I going to lose any benefits? And especially like in the African-American culture, because a lot of us or a lot of our cultural differences, like if I come in and see the doctor, will I lose some of my benefits that I have? Will I lose my Social Security benefits? Will I be able to get Social Security disability? And these are true questions that our culture asks. And it's like, no, these are things to make sure that we're keeping you healthy, trying to keep you, you know, alive and well as long as we can for you to live and thrive in life. So these are, you know, access, cultural geographics all play, you know, a major part. And it's just not enough to go around. And it's not enough to go around. You know, it's a small team of all of us trying to help, but we're here.
I think too, for young people, we need to look at access as far as even internet access, depending on where they live. Because a lot of the information, especially for communities that in countries that don't have an association set up, or even if they do have an association set up, but they don't have access to be able to see them in person, or they're run by volunteers, and it's really hard. And so you need to have that access to internet. And we run into that all the time globally, where it is more difficult to have some of those conversations. And so what does that bandwidth look like at your house to be able to join virtual meetings or support calls? You know, can you participate in surveys and registries if you don't have stable access? And so I think that that's also a really important thing too. There's the physical access to medical support, but then let's, you know, really look at some of those emotional and social access issues that can come to play when people are trying to find other stories and just hear from other people, especially when it comes to some of those cultural stigmas and barriers where there may not have an openness inside their home or with their friend group or in their town to be able to share feelings and emotions. There needs to be that outlet to seek out sources in almost an anonymous way, to really understand that they truly aren't alone. And that's a really important thing, especially for young people.
Yeah.
So let's talk about some hesitations and likeliness for some different topics and seeking out different support within your communities. And I want to talk about, you know, hesitation, but also how likely, because there might be some communities that are hesitant and then some who it's not really a factor when it comes to their decisions that they make based off of these different topics. So specifically with seeking out support from a medical professional or social worker, and that can include occupational therapist, physical therapist, neurologist, what have you, how likely or how hesitant is your community for that first outreach and continuation? And we heard just a little bit about it, but I really wanted to dive a little bit more into that.
I can start on that one, but for our for my African American community, it is very hesitant to reach out to a social worker. There is a stigma in our culture of you reach out to a social worker is there to take everything away from you. And they're not there to help you with anything. And it's a stigma and a barrier that I have been helping to try to break down within our community of explaining what a social worker really does. But this is going on. This has been going on from generation to generation to generation, is that you don't let a social worker into your business or into your home or into your appointments as an African American family. It was taught to my parents. It was taught to a lot of my people that my patients and families that I see here. And so breaking down that barrier is something that is on the top of my list that I continue to work with my patients on. So as soon as I say, hey, you want to see the social worker? They're like, no. And I'm like, let's talk about it. And then I get that information of why that hesitancy, which, you know, I know, but then understanding and hearing from that this is a cultural thing. This is what, you know, we don't talk to social workers. But how do we break that? How do we break that? And some great ideas that, you know, I could think about right now of how we break that cycle. But interested to hear from Jacky and Juan Carlos on how their culture would react to that as well.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah, I can see that. Yeah. From African American community, thank you for sharing. Yeah, if you Asian or AAPI community, I will say that there's, as I mentioned earlier, there's a lot of cultural beliefs and religious beliefs, or like, you know, traditional beliefs about seeking support right outside of the home. It is considered as a sign of weakness. Yeah, people think your family is in trouble. They will think that you're being cursed. You know, like you're having bad luck. You know, so there's a lot of, you know, these beliefs, and then people will talk about, you know, this family behind their back, you know, so that's why they tend to, you know, just deal with it themselves, like try to hide it or like just prolong it, you know, procrastinate the support, right? And also I work with LGBTQIA community as well. And I can see that they also hesitant to reach out to medical support. So say for example, like some of the individuals, they worry about being misgendered, you know, they're a lot of times, you know, they have fear of judgment. Sometimes they think that their healthcare providers may lack culturally competent care. And they may make some remarks or some microaggressions that they experience during, you know, this medical setting, right? So they just don't bother to go out, reach out for support because they fear of being hurt, fear of being rejected. So I can see that as well in our communities. Yeah.
In Costa Rica, maybe I think that seek out medical support, or maybe a social worker, or maybe a different kind of therapist. People know that they are people from resources, and the people know that they can help us in different ways. So I think that maybe medical resources or maybe social worker resources are very good accepted by the community in Costa Rica.
Yeah, thank you for that. I think those are all really important points. And I think that we can make assumptions, but it's great to hear from everybody on some of those different barriers and reasons why. Let's talk specifically about a mental and emotional health and support. What are some of the hesitations and likelihood of people seeking out those services?
It is, I'll start again. It is definitely, I don't know how, well, I'll say this in the way that we say it in the cultural. You don't go see a crazy person. And what they mean is that you don't go see a psychiatrist or anyone to talk about any of your emotions, because it's seen as a sign of weakness, and that we should be able to handle our emotions and handle it within the culture or within the family without going to sit down with someone. So mm-hmm. It is very hesitant in our culture to sit down and have any conversations with any kind of mental health professional. It is a big no-no. Mm-hmm. And it's a very, very sad no-no in our culture. But slowly trying to break that stigma away. When you even look at the numbers of African Americans that are going to see psychiatrists, which are in the low, the last numbers I pulled was like 13-14% within this region, but then you have a higher number of suicide and overdose rate, which is a lot higher, that have had access to be able to see a mental health person, well, we could have saved a lot of those folks if we didn't have the stigmas that we have in our culture. So just sharing some of that.
Thank you. Yeah, so
I'm
I
Carlos.
Agree. Oh, sorry, yeah. Hello. Sorry.
I think that this is our biggest problem because they seek out the emotional and mental support. It's very difficult because nobody wants to be in a judgment that you are a crazy person. Mm-hmm. And this is a cultural stigma. If you go to the psychiatric doctor, or maybe if you want to go to the psychologist, you have a problem and you have to accept it. And for the culture or for the society, if you accept that you have a problem, a health problem, mental health problem, you are crazy. And you have to be alone because in sometimes you are dangerous. And it's real difficult when you have to give some support and recommend to some person that go and get some support in mental health because it's very important. Maybe your headache is because you are thinking, your thoughts are fighting with you, and you have to go to get some support. It's very important for you, but I'm not crazy. And I'm not gonna accept that I'm crazy. So I think that this is the biggest problem that we have in our culture.
So it sounds like there's more acceptance to get support from social workers and to get a diagnosis when it comes to your medical health. But when it comes to mental health, which you could argue is medical,
yeah,
there's less acceptance of that, is kind of what you're saying.
Yeah. Everybody yeah. just wants a pill that for your problem. That's all. But doesn't want to talk about it, doesn't want to talk about how I feel because this is a problem, because I don't want to be sick, and I don't want to recognize or accept that I have a problem.
Thank you, Jacky.
Yeah, so I also want to second what Juan Carlos said, because like, you know, if you seek mental health support, you are considered as crazy in our culture, in Asian cultures, and they think you are dangerous. Actually, like in a lot of social media, a lot of newspapers, like on when you turn on TV, on the news, like, you know, the press, right, they magnify like the people experiencing like mental health crisis, like they do something dangerous, or like they being violent and all that. Like this kind of narrative have been perpetuated a lot, you know, on in social settings, like in our everyday life. Like when you turn on TV, like they talk about this person with mental health crisis, like doing this bad thing, that bad thing. A lot of, you know, this create, you know, like a social stigma, right, around our community. People who are, you know, have a mental health diagnosis is considered as violent, as dangerous. We should stay away from them. So people rather not go get support and be diagnosed if they are experiencing mental health issues, right? So they want to shy away from those stigma, right? They don't want to be rejected by society, by their family members. So it's still heavily stigmatized in my community because people will say a lot of bad words behind their back and all that kind of thing. So that's why in API or Asian communities, they don't reach out to mental health provider for support, emotional support, because of this heavy stigma, because of their social climate, right?
Yeah, thank you all for sharing that. Let's talk about peer support, and let's also add in support from different advocacy and associations. What's the hesitation or likelihood of people reaching out for that kind of support? I'll let anybody start.
Okay. I thought Jacky was about to say something.
Yeah.
I was waiting to.
Okay, so I can start then. Yeah, so I think, this is really important for different professional and support communities, to come together and we can do a better job, you know? So for example, we should prioritize cultural competence, right? And sensitivity in our practices. So as a social worker, I have learned a lot, gone through a lot of training about being culturally sensitive, learn about different cultures, be humble, right? Cultural humility is also very prevalent, training right now. Like we need to be flexible, right? Not to make assumptions, learn how to practice empathy, right, in our practices. So it is very important that, this kind of culturally sensitive, responsive care and practices are being fostered, are being, emphasized, in our HD organizations, among mental health providers, among, medical providers, even research and industry partners as well. So I feel like this kind of, concept has to be more strengthened, in our communities. Yeah.
So would it be fair to say that that when you're looking at the AAPI community, that there could be that fear or a misunderstanding, or, how likely are they to speak with someone else within the community who's impacted by HD, for example, or to reach out to different advocacy organizations to reach out for help?
Yeah, definitely. And I think it is also important to have representations, from different cultures as well. HDYO, we have ambassadors from different parts of the world. So they have representation in Latin America, Asia, because people, the familiarity, right? People will put their gap down, if they see someone like speaking your language, or someone who look like you, or someone who maybe been to your places or know a little bit about your culture, been to, maybe Africa before, Europe before, and then you draw some commonalities, right? Those really important things to connect people, and they put their guard down, and their stigma is trying to will slowly diminish, and then they will be open up. Yeah, so that's why I'm thinking that's really important. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
I would say, peers in the community, I think one thing about the African-American culture is that they will talk amongst the family. They'll talk amongst the family, but they won't say what it actually is. But you will have those conversations throughout the families. To Jackie's point of reaching out to organizations, a lot of our African-American community is very hesitant to reach out to any organization that doesn't have basically someone that looks like them that they feel that they can go to and trust. And it's just a, hey, I know that, I get this all the time. Hey, Dom, I heard that you're doing this and I saw you talking about this. Is this a good organization that I should go in, talk to? Is there someone there who you trust that I can put trust into that, I will feel comfortable having that conversation with about? And literally that's how the conversation starts. Mm-hmm. And it's always, is this someone who you trust? Because I trust you as someone who looks like me and understands our cultural. If you don't trust them, I'm not going to them. So they don't trust the connection if it's not someone that looks like them trusts that connection. And sometimes, they're like, oh, I didn't get in touch with you. I wasn't able to talk to you. I'm like, well, you talk to my colleague. And but the colleague is not you.
Yeah.
And, it's a sad reality, is that it is what it has come down. And sometimes, even we're out on vacation and different things like that. And sometimes people miss out on opportunities to connect with amazing people at amazing organizations that can help and give great information. But because they're like, I didn't talk to that one person that I trust, they miss out on that opportunity. And it's, you know, it's something, you know, as we talked about cultural sensitivity, you know, having that sympathy and empathy to try to, you know, empathize and sympathize with them, but getting them to understand that the being, you know, we're one big community and we're just trying to bridge it all together. And, you know, the same trust that you instilled into me is that I'm hoping that you would instill that into someone else at the organizations who are able to help as well. My hope is that we continue to try to break those barriers. But it's very hard in the African-American community. It is completely hard. And it's one that we have to work on.
I think about to peer support, there may be association in the community. Sometimes all that we need is someone who listen what we have to say. Mm-hmm. And sometimes these people is out of our family because we can trust and we can talk about something that hurt us, and we don't want to be we don't want to be in our family like a crying people or like a crying person or like a sad person, because you have to be a people from resources for your family. But with somebody in a community or somebody with your similar situation or maybe is here for you, and sometimes just we need that somebody listen us. And everything that you have to say, you know that somebody has the empathy to understand how you are feeling and has maybe some words that you have today. Do you need today these words that somebody need have to you?
I think it's that safety in strangers almost, that there's that safety because there is no preconceived opinion. There is no judgment on that. And I think that that's really powerful. And I think that that's what kind of the reason that the ambassador program existed was for that representation, for that cultural competency and a seat at the table, but also for these people to come together globally where they can send each other messages and you may not have ever met them in person, but they just get it. And I think that that's so important. And to Dom's point about that trust factor of it, it's also hard. People aren't comfortable enough to come to the table and to be able to share their story. It's hard to get all of those different representation elements to be able to build that trust from the outside looking in. And so we all just have to do so much better because it can make such a huge difference. And it's one brave step for everybody to be able to make that push out. And then for us as an advocacy community to foster that relationship and to comfort them almost. Thank you all for sharing that. And now this is a really big one. What's the hesitancy and likelihood of your communities that we're speaking about today and participating in research? And that can be anything from clinical research to surveys or registries or questionnaires or observational studies. What does that look like? Dom, I know you're just chomping at the bit. I'm going to let you start.
All right. I was going to wait. I was taking a deep breath. But research is one that weighs very heavily in the African-American community. It is a heavy stigma, you know, dating back to, you know, only, you know, less than what, 60, 70 years ago. Hasn't even been, you know, 100 years of the, you know, the first thing I hear is that, you know, what happened in Tuskegee, you know, with the syphilis trial, and why would I want to participate in a, you know, a trial that is, or not even just trial, just in research in general, of what, how our culture say it. And I'm trying to make sure, you know, I just want everyone to know is that the way that I'm saying things is how we say it in the culture, just to be cultural respective. But it's like what they did to my people, and why would I participate? And if you're really going to just draw blood on me, or are you going to put something else into me? You know, we remember what happened. And it's a, you know, it's a thing that, you know, not just, you know, that's just one of many studies that happened, but it's also the one that most people are most famous with. And that when you look at also what research studies in the African-American community, you have research trials that have zero African-Americans enrolled across the, and I'll say in the United States, you have studies for not just for Huntington's that sometimes doesn't have any African-Americans. You have other, you know, studies of other neurological diseases, and I'll stick with neurological diseases, that have no African-American patients enrolled. And the reason that we see this is because, and I actually did a survey on this a few weeks ago, and I'm still collecting data on it, but it's more of the cultural of the African-American community does not feel comfortable having someone that does not look like them telling them about a study, and someone that's not able to really explain to them from a cultural perspective on how the trial or how the study is going to go, whether it's informational, whether it's drug, no matter what kind of study it is, there's a great sense of hesitation. And my colleagues also see it as well here as well. But it's like, how do I break that? So what's happening is that we have, you know, I'm starting to do more research. I'm starting to help out with more of the research studies. And being able to explain it on a different level that brings it down to a cultural differences. Because the way that I may explain a study to someone in an African-American culture may not be the same way that I explain it to someone of a Native American culture, because I have to be respectful of the cultural differences and the different beliefs that may be within it. But I'm still going through the same consent form. I'm still making sure that, you know, the research coordinators are doing, you know, they're doing the same exact thing that they're doing. But it's all because it's someone who looks like them, who is explaining it to them and able to take it step by step, is that they only will agree. But if you say, hey, I have a research study, I'm going to have a study that's coming out months from now, but they agree to it today, and you don't do it today, a lot of times in the African-American culture, if we say yeah, if you get someone to say yes right then and there, you have to get it done right then and there. There is no coming back, because our culture will say, well, you should have got it done when I was here. Now I don't want to participate. I don't want to do anything about it. They just don't believe in that. And it's down from our culture. Also, you know, not to forget that there are certain guidelines that have, you know, changed to fit, you know, somewhat to fit the cultural, instead of based off of the individual race. So sometimes you have where, you know, some of the guidelines may say, they look at from an African-American perspective, and then it may be some other ties that's tied into it. And they're just like, well, you know what? You just don't fit this. So you have a lot of African-Americans that also get excluded from research, that may want to be excluded from research because they have so many other things that's going on. And those things happen because we don't talk about what's happening. So we didn't know that mom maybe also had, you know, diabetes, blood pressure, all these other things that may be a factor for being able to participate in research.
You're talking about the inclusion criteria, maybe unawaringly
not allowed.
Yep.
Right. So much hesitation from a research perspective of just getting African-Americans to even talk about it. Because mm-hmm. the minute that you say research, it is an immediately no. And it's like, well, let me just have a conversation with you and let you know what's going on. And it's literally like me having a sit-down conversation because literally I get told no. But it's like, let me talk to you. And then once I'm able to talk about it and take it down to a cultural level that's culturally appropriate, it helps out so much more. But not everyone does that. Not everyone has a, have a, as I could say, myself, who can be a representation. I know you have some sort of representation, but I just wanna, it's something that weighs very heavily on me. And you probably see I'm continuing to go on and on and on about it, but it weighs very heavily on me. And it is such a passion of mine to help get more African Americans into research to help us, because there is something there that, with genetics and genes and different things that we just don't see. And that could be something that can help us when it comes to HD. And particularly like in my patients that I see, I see them on different variants. We just don't know. We got to get them to participate into research to help us with how we can better, get disease modifying drugs for for HD. And I'll shut up for a second. I'll shut
No,
up because I've been talking for a lot.
I was gonna just bring this to an international level, just for those who aren't familiar with some of the things that have happened in the US. Underrepresented communities, people of color have been used almost in an experimental way, to put it nicely, with different research that's been done. Native American communities, African American communities, some really big studies and things that have happened that were very bad. I'm just gonna put it lightly. So there is, and that wasn't that long ago. And so it's really a lot of recovery and fear on top of that, which to Dom's point is really resonating and still very much in the forefront of how people can think of research. So yeah, just wanted to broaden that out. For those who might not be familiar with some of the practices in the US in the past years. Jacky, Juan Carlos.
I think that about the research, our culture for us is maybe it's difficult because we don't have a lot of development in scientific research. So usually you can hear about the countries with more development in scientific research. In Costa Rica, there is not an opportunity to participate in some research or clinical research or maybe scientific research because we are a small country in developing something about the typical disease, maybe, but not for mental health or maybe in HD. So we are not. We have not maybe the experience to participate in this kind of research.
So it sounds like it's an access issue. So it's not even on the table. So the feelings aren't developed yet because you just don't know.
I also think that there in Asian countries, API communities, I think there's a lot of hesitancy because of colonialism, like especially in some parts of Asia, where I'm from, in Hong Kong, we were once like a British colony, like, and also like this kind of like a Western medicine, like Western like scientific research and all those things that are foreign to a lot of Asian communities. So they have a lot of reservations. They have a lot of wonder if they come, if their research companies come to, Asia, like in China, like they may have the thought, is it like legitimate? Like they are they treating us like lab rat? Like this kind of mentality is happening. So that's create hesitancy among Asian communities, especially I think in Chinese community, because we have our own system of like medicine, like Chinese medicine. We have our own beliefs about medication, about Eastern medicine. So that's why they may not fully trust Western medicine, right? So there's some type of some kind of hesitancy there. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, thank you all so much for sharing. That's a really, all of these are so important for the research community to hear. And for the community members, I feel like this is an important thing to also promote is that HDYO has an international survey series that we are using in order to advocate on behalf of your voices. The first one was premiered last year, and it's still open, and it's about how can we better communicate with you when it comes to different educational pieces and what's valuable to you. And that's really important. So as we're looking at ways that you find are easy mediums for you to understand in the format that's best for you, we can help lobby to our different partners, research, advocacy, organizational, medical, to be able to utilize those channels to get information as quickly and easily to you as possible. And one that we just premiered in January, which goes hand in hand with this, is what are those emotional and educational barriers when it comes to research and different research terms. And this is international. We have it translated into many languages right now and continue to offer those. But this is a great way to get that number and those large numbers of feedback. So then we can go in again and share this information so we can all do better. So I really encourage you to take a look at that at hdyo.org. Reach out to us because it's an anonymous way to share your voice without having to identify yourself in any way. So please do consider that because we automatically go straight to clinical research, but there are so many other opportunities to share your opinions that matter in under the great umbrella of research. So check that out. Well, this has been an extremely important conversation, beginning part of this conversation, because this is just the tip of the iceberg. I really want to hear from you all of what do you want to see from all of the greater HD community who are helping support different cultures. So that could be the research professionals, medical professionals, advocacy professionals, mental health. What do you want to see? What can we do better? I know that it's not that simple, but just want to hear some probing thoughts from you all about that.
I think one thing we can do better is to organize, like we are doing the registry, in HDYO, mm-hmm. like for the JHD registry. I think like some initiative part, like a project, like combine like different efforts, right? Like come together, like have a really like a, for example, we have like a annual congress. We are doing annual congress, like mm-hmm. those opportunities for everyone to come together to listen to their stories, like to listen to different communities share. I think it's really important, really powerful. I think I remember like a saying called personal is political, like a personal experience is really important to tell, storytelling is really important. I encourage people to share their stories, and for organizations, they listen, they accept, and make changes, take action. And then I hope more task force, more collaborations happen to dismantle these cultural stigmas, these, barriers to access to care. I hope more collaboration will be amazing. Yeah. So yeah, this is my little opinion. Yeah, hopefully we can come together and make the world better for HD community.
Basically, I want to say that we have to remember that behind an HD person, there is a family that is living this process as well. So we have to know that there is a mom, there is a dad, there is a brother, maybe there is one son that is feeling a lot of fear because doesn't know how comes and what comes in the future. If we can contribute to support something like this situation to support this feeling, we are doing a big difference in their lives. So we have to think that there is not just one person in one family. We have one family that is living this process, and we have to try to get to be a support for all of them.
Yeah. Man, Jacky and Juan, you said it kind of like all together. You know, remembering that, you know, from an advocacy standpoint, that we continue to, you know, advocate for ourselves, advocate for our families, advocate for our loved ones, our extended families, bringing on that support that we need from not just from medical, but for community, and also for ourselves as healthcare professionals and as caregivers and caretakers, but then also making sure that we are continuing to not let the cultural stigmas stop us from providing great care and not stopping us from reaching out to someone else that may be able to help assist us with those cultural stigmas and help walk through those cultural stigmas with you to get those communities to participate. The only way that we will continue to bring about, as you know, a world of, you know, of us providers and community coming together, is just us just coming together as one. And being able, as we all have the same goal, our same goal is to make sure that we help families and loved ones and providers and, you know, keep them educated on HD. And we want to, you know, continue to, you know, have these conversations about these cultural stigmas and continue to build on it. And the way that we look at it is that we, you know, this is just one of many conversations that we're just looking forward to bring forth, you know, joy, happiness, and peace within all of us. So that's it.
Oh, that's all amazing. I mean, it's just all amazing. I really appreciate these insights, and I think it's important for all of us to do better. And to understand that everybody is different, and that we need to meet them at the place in their journey and where they come from, how they grew up, what culture they identify in. Those all play into a big factor of that. And it's not a one size fits all approach. That's kind of what I'm hearing. And we all need to continue to ask questions and to have that open mind and empathy to continue forward to better support. So before I wrap up, any last thoughts from you all?
No.
Okay.
I just want to free of HD. That's all.
Absolutely. Yes. No, I mean, this is just tremendous. And so thank you all so much for your time, Jacky, Juan Carlos, Dom, such a fantastic conversation. And again, it's just one piece of the conversation that we need to continue to have and that we will continue to have. At any point, if you need support, if you want to get connected or just someone to talk to, please reach out to us at HDYO, to your local association, to anybody who has a listening ear and an open heart, because we're all here to support you in this disease that can sometimes feel incredibly isolating. But there's a world of people there that are behind you and want to be here to hug you and love you and virtually, sometimes not in person, but be there to support you. So thank you all so much for taking the time today. And we hope you enjoyed this edition of Breaking Down Barriers, and we'll see you next time.